Okay, Frank's going to make us a goblet, long stem goblet. Normally when you see somebody make a long stem goblet, it's hanging out about this far and you're just sitting there waiting for the stem to break off. But Frank's going to show us how to do it where it's foolproof and never will break off, right?
No. If it breaks off, you haven't lost the whole goblet. The whole thing here is you make the top part of the goblet out of your fancy, expensive piece of wood. That by itself. Then you make your stem out of a less expensive straight grain wood. And you can make the foot a part of this, or you can make it separately. The thing here is, if you, one of my favorite woods to turn goblets and make boxes out of is tulip wood. A piece of 18 inch tulip wood, three inches around, costs about $90. Now, do I want to turn a nice goblet out of the top of this and waste all that in the section, all that on the floor? Where I could say take a section, maybe get five goblets out of the expensive stuff, use the least expensive stuff to make the stem and the foot. And that way you can make a bunch of goblets and then another day make the stem. And that's the thing that makes it safe. It makes it safe because the part that if it's going to break it all, it's going to be while you're working on that stem. Okay?
And I guess because you would have had the goblet on it, then it really...
Yeah, you know, you got to figure out some way to keep it from bouncing around. And then if you get an oops in there, this is broke, and you can't put it back together. So the goblet's lost, too. This way, I usually turn the stem, then I'll turn the goblet separately. Turn the foot separately. Okay? This is a piece of cherry. I think this would be, if not mistaken, that's a piece of babinga. I'm going to make the goblet out of that piece.
Probably put the camera on. So we can
switch it over a second. Okay.
Need to make this round. One of the reasons you need a big piece, because I'm going to hold this thing in a chuck and cut off little sections at a time, at a time, whittle it on down, little at a time, whittle it on down, while I've got the mass out there holding it in place so it doesn't whip around. Okay? Roughing gouge. If you got any questions along the way, yell them out. And anybody that's done goblets sees a better way to do it or something I missed, yell that out too. Because goblets are one of those things, it's like Christmas ornaments. I don't do it every day. I get a run on where I'll get a person that wants one or two. So then I'll go through the process of making a bunch of them.
Why'd you start with such a large piece of wood?
Rigidity. I'm going to stick this in the chuck and that's going to be hanging out there. I'm just trying to make it round now. Now, normally I would make it out of a piece about this size in the shop, but audiences always want to see the demonstrator screw up, and I won't afford you that chance. Oops. Yeah, if you're not doing an oops, you're not hurrying and you're not turning. Okay. It's just so it goes in my chuck, nice and tight. 2 1/4, parting tool. Make the tenon to go in the chuck. I do not want it to bottom out in the chuck because the chuck is not a true bottom. Okay. There's my piece. And I cut it so that when I clamp down on that with the chuck, I've got all the teeth biting into it as opposed to holding it by the corners. When I clamp this down, I want all these teeth all the way around. If I open this up and only those corners, I have a tendency to want, it has a tendency to want to rot. But if I cut the tenon so that when I tighten it down, this is almost closed, that is the strongest point for this. Okay.
Mom and Dan up there with a cast, they're betting whether it's
going to
make it or not.
Yeah.
Is that what they're doing?
I got five on the side here.
What?
Oh.
You can see what they're doing? They're up there betting on whether it's going to break or not break.
Well, actually, being the method you're going to do it,
yeah.
It
takes a
lot. We're betting on the mean and the time that it's going to take for Hans to catch that piece over there when it does break.
I'm looking for the catcher's mask.
Huh?
Is that a talon chuck?
It's a talon chuck, which means that I got a 90-degree angle in there. There's no dovetail. I want this to bite straight down there. If this was a dovetail-type chuck like the Vic Mark, I'd have a dovetail there. I do have Vic Mark chucks, but when it comes to wanting to hold something, I like my talon or the one-way chucks. Nice and tight. I don't want that flopping around at all. Off a little bit, but I'll just straighten it out. Temporarily bring up the tailstock. I'm going to go back and fix that. It will haunt me later. Let's see.
You already got a mark on that.
It could be the chuck where I beat up the jaws, turned away half the face of the jaws, which happens occasionally. I'm gonna take off a little part of that because that's where my hole is going to start, and I don't want to play around and get it off to start with because everything goes bad after that. Here again, my favorite tool is my quarter-inch bowl gouge. I use that like I use a spindle gouge. The only time I really use a spindle gouge is when I got a tight space and can't get into it. See in a minute why I need that dead center. Tail stock, slightly loose, let it settle in, lock it down. Okay. One more time here. I don't want you to have to catch. Who's my catcher over there? All of them.
I've always been a catcher. So.
It all depends on which way the curve goes.
If you miss it, Hans Dijkstra's one. Don't miss.
See, what I planned on doing was
Duck. You're that quick?
You gotta be quick, real quick.
Yeah, but you're just, it could do.
One of those might have a longer post.
It could go just as easily your way.
Yeah.
This one is a longer post.
Okay, there you go. Who made the posts here? We got, I know we got a tool maker in the bunch here.
Tommy Rowland, but he's not here.
No. I think he did make it though.
And those of you who turn, or those of us who turn a lot, we know the days, there are days we can go in the shop and everything works like a charm. Our favorite tool works. And the days we go in there and some of the best things we ever tried to do don't work out right.
Aw, shit.
And our best efforts fail us. So you're going to see me try a couple of different things. And this really depends on the wood sometime. And I haven't figured out which one works yet. Sometimes I will use this little parting tool to remove wood to get down to where I want to be. Other times, I will use the one-way easy rougher that has a raised, radius edge on it. I'll use that to clean up. And then sometimes, if that doesn't work, I'll use my good old-fashioned skew. Then, when all else fails, those fails. Anybody ever heard of the nano tools? There's a guy that sells these things. They're just like the easy roughers, but they're just a little smaller tool. He never turns anything big with these. But all of these tools may or may not come into play. Well, let me turn that around so it does not bounce as much as it is.
How smaller are we going to get, roughly?
I'm going to start up here for safety, where the stem not meets the bottom of the bowl, but where the stem, after the coupling, about an eighth of an inch. An eighth of an inch, and it'll grow bigger as it goes down. Okay? Is that... You look surprised.
Just all the wood you're wasting up a scroll saw.
No. I just like said. I was going to get it.
Now that he's tried some turning, he's getting over that.
Uh-huh. Yeah, Hey, I haven't said anything.
Yeah, I figured out how to use the shaving kit. That's all.
To those who did not hear, one of the reasons I was late getting here, I've been a victim of the Atlanta freeze. I had a pipe burst in my kitchen cabinet. So I got kitchen, living room, dining room, hallway, all flooded. Huh?
Can you use the wind savings to suck up the water? I couldn't relate to that.
My guns were locked up, so I didn't commit suicide. It's not a good feeling to walk downstairs and go squish, squish, squish. And then as you walk, it's still squish, squish, squish.
And it was still coming out.
Yeah. And I'd gotten hold of every place that I thought I needed to insulate. I had one corner cabinet in the kitchen, dishwasher here, the sink and over here. This one was empty. There's nothing back there except the pipes coming up through the slab and all that kind of stuff. Well, lo and behold, that's the same place that the connection goes to the water outlet outside.
Oh, no.
And when we opened that, you could just feel the breeze coming through that little gap around there, and that's what, you know. Now, before I take away any more weight, I'm gonna make myself a little place here, because I've got to drill a hole in there, an 1/8 inch hole. Which tool am I gonna use to do that? I'll use my spindle guide. I do it now while it's big, because if I wait until I get down to this around will probably be about 1/4 inch. If I wait till I get down there and I try to shape that off, I'll liable to get frayed edges. This way, I'll turn it down, that won't happen. This one has to be straight. This is part of the process you're going to need to hold this thing in place. Yeah. And I'm only going to go in about a hair over 1/4 inch.
Will you use like toothpicks in to put them together with spring?
No, I put a little tenon on the end of the goblet. That's good enough. Okay.
Precise 1/4 inch.
Pardon me?
That was a precise 1/4 inch.
Was it? I'm gonna need that later on.
And his tendon is probably the same 1/4 inch.
I mean, this doesn't drill the hole in.
So, this is the. What's that? I don't want that to look too bulky, so I'll measure. Do we have a light? I could use some light here. What's that?
We got some magnetic base on it.
We got a magnetic base on
there.
Okay.
Give myself a little room to work here.
That's easier.
Thank you.
Now, there are times where I will flare this out a little bit more, so it's almost like a little miniature saucer that's going to sit in. I'm going to just make it straight up and down tonight. That is the one thing, this is the one thing you must do. You must sand as you go, because I go down another inch, I can't come back for this.
Would a live spinner support cause
No, I'm going to do that later on, yes. I'm going to do that. Not that I don't believe you. Okay. I just want to make sure I don't cut into it. There are times when you can, you may want to put rings on here or something, decorate it to make it simple. Let's just go without. We got a little step there. We'll use that little step as our line of demarcation. Another thing you need to do is that's a quarter. Scared me there. Thought that was my eighth. Because you're so intent on not breaking this thing, every now and then you need to just step back away from it and look at it. There's a time I needed to do 24 of these for a wedding, and by the time I got through, I had the worst migraine headache you ever had.
All the stress of it, hope you don't screw up.
Still married?
Huh?
Are you still married?
Oh yeah. Even know
it says 820.
Probably pretty,
what's that?
Probably pretty slow right here in the center where you work.
Occasionally, what I'll do, because I'll use maple or cherry or something like that, what I'll do is stain that piece of wood. Hey. Yeah, I didn't bring it with me.
I got one of his all the way.
We got any Turner's finish or spray of shellac?
No.
It's all right. We can go with that.
Is it aerosol?
I think it was Waco or something like that. I think maybe Waco or something.
What,
like
you,
that.
You spray aerosol, spray your
yeah. Anything that dries real quick. This whole secret here, you want to leave all this here, that'll hopefully keep it from.
How long is that stand going to be?
I'll get down there and stop, there's no sense in it. Well. As you go down, you just keep repeating. And you really need to step back and look and see, okay, am I getting big too quickly? No, the largest part is going to be at the bottom. It should be getting a little larger as we go.
Some
Ryan
Brown's best friction polish, or
you know, it's usually
like, but
that's
not the same as
those. That's your defense. Use Ryan Brown's. See, I've got some.
That's clear. Go ahead. There you go.
That's focusing on the wood shavings.
Yeah, you can see the wood fibers.
There you go.
No, that's not staying.
Yeah.
I don't think it has a manual focus. I don't believe.
Turn it more to the large part of your turnish. Maybe it'll focus on that.
Problem is, it's spinning.
Yeah.
Oh, you good.
I'd leave well enough alone.
Stop while you're here.
Some of Ron Brown's best here, I guess. Okay. Get a little support here.
Thank you.
much of the bulk there as you can. Probably 400, that's more than enough. Leave it a little rough so you don't, it doesn't slip through your fingers, like a regular wine glass. Regular, but I'm not going. Normally, I would take a flat piece, a piece of wood, something like this, with sandpaper, flatten out the little lumps. But my parting tool. What did that do? Oh. I know what I was looking for, the one with the wood in hand. That's why you do this process, so that if it breaks, using that bowl guy is almost like a little shovel. Yeah, about an inch at a time, that's enough, yeah. Not all the way, but down to there. Yeah. I was in a class once with, I forgot who it was, but we got blocks of wood and everybody tried to turn a 20-incher. You can do it. It's not that hard. You just, if you take your time. But you know, after you get about 8 or 9 inches of this, you start rushing. And all you have to do is let that tool ride under there once. It comes up, it's gone. It shouldn't. Well, it's in there, it's got the little point in there. Even if that flexes, I still got this. There's very little holding that. That hole in there is just holding it in place to keep it from bouncing up. It's not in there keeping it straight. It's just keeping it from bouncing.
What's the purpose of that part you're doing now?
This.
What part is this going to play in the base?
This is the stem. You're going to have a little vase up there and a stem about that long and a foot. Okay.
Did you bring an extra stem that was already done?
No.
That's confidence. I would have had the extra there in case I broke this in the front.
Well, see, the thing is, what happens if I break that one, then I just get a short one. I make a short one real quick. Yeah. See, like right now, if I stopped right now, it'd be done. If you look, it's not, it's moving around a little bit. That's the way, it's not really moving that much.
Have you got enough pressure on that to spin the last center?
Watch in a minute, there you go.
I can see it.
Okay, well, it's spinning now.
Okay.
It's spinning now. That's more than I want.
Yep.
No, it's not. There are times when I'll put, if this is a little bit bigger, rather than put it on that, I'll put the cone, invert the cone, and put that on there. It's the one way, double ended. I don't know. Is that a U or a V?
It's like a parabolic.
Yeah.
It's like a quarter inch, so it's actually 3/8.
Well, no. This is the quarter inch. That's the 3/8. Was that a question? What? Nah, that was that not fair. First of all, you could have slipped that on afterwards. See, if it breaks now, all I'm out of is just a piece of cherry instead of an expensive piece of tulip or coca bolo or something.
Are you getting any tear up or using a burning tool on
that? No, because this is really, working, almost working like a negative rake scraper as opposed to a regular scraper. See, the regular scraper, that, now, my, I'll show you here. You can hear the difference now. See that, opposed to, that's, it's not grabbing as much. Yeah.
I see you put that tool away.
I got a straight one.
Yeah, he's done using it now.
That tool.
And see, I need to practice a little here because I'm going to use this to form that little pedestal for the bass.
When you're practicing on the way out. Huh?
What's that?
You're practicing on the way back.
Huh? Yeah. Yeah, way back. Okay, parting tool. Normally I talk when I'm demonstrating, but this, like I said before, requires a little bit of concentration. It got fat all of a sudden. See, it's getting a little fatter now. And that's right. High fuel friction power. Ron Brown special. And I should watch it out there because something like this will grab, wrap itself around, and I'll have two pieces instead of one. You're right. Remember I told you, you get to the bottom and you start rushing?
You get in a hurry.
You do.
Yeah, I've only got a couple more inches to go.
That last inch gives you help.
Those of you who know about David Ellsworth, have just heard about it, but have never seen him, he's one of those turners you should see. And then, not only is he a good turner, but he explains very well what he's doing as he's going along. I've been to this place up in, not Bloomberg, but what's the other place? Quakertown. Quakertown, Pennsylvania, a couple of times. He is a character, though. Hollow forms. That's what he was the first person that came along with hollowing these things out through small openings. He came up with these little wires and stuff like that. He's not as old as me, but he's up there. See, I'm an old person.
There's a book out here, David Ellsworth on wood turning. It's probably the best book I've ever read on dealing with how you shape the tool, how you use the tool.
You say he's not old enough for Medicare?
No.
He's old enough for Obamacare.
What's the name of the book?
David Ellsworth on wood turning.
But it's for making tools?
No, well, he does that too. He's got it making tools, but he tells you how he grinds a tool and how to actually use the tool as far as presenting the cutting edge to the wood.
It's out here.
Yeah.
Yeah, when you go up to his shop, one of the things you do is you make a handle for the tool if you want to buy it. And he's got a couple of the new lathes now, but in the old days when he had general lathes, part of the thing that people want to see him do when he turns overseas, he likes to straddle the lathe and hold it back. Everybody wants to see him ride the lathe. So when I went up there, he had to get out a couple of boxes for me to straddle the lathe. But everybody straddles the lathe. You been to the shop?
No, I read his book. Oh. It was cheap. He's consistent. I mean, what he says on the DVD is what he says in the book.
We need to move this down.
And the thing is, before I went to see him, the first time I ever saw him demonstrate, I'd seen his videos and all that stuff, and listened to him in person, word for word. Word for word. Yeah, Jordan. I got a little fat place here in the middle, and I'm not going to go back and fix it now. I don't want to give the naysayers the satisfaction.
Getting close to stopping.
I don't have it with me, but I've got a little chart where I go down so many inches and I measure, and I didn't bring that with me. I think that's enough. You think that's enough? Oh, go further.
How big
a
base you got to put on that now?
Well, the base should be the same size or a little bit bigger than whatever the top's going to be. Start to work on that. My base is going to be out here at the bottom, but I'm going to have about that much flowing from this stem out into that. So part of the base is going to be this piece here. Get my flat. Not the whole base. This is going to be part of it. There's another piece for the base. This will sit. Now I won't be able to come back to this.
You leave that little step on there?
Yeah, I want to leave that. It's almost like the end. I'm going to undercut that a little bit, but I also have to leave an eighth of an inch little tenon on there, because that's going to fit into the base, just like the top's going to fit into that. So I need to go in here and give myself a little room. Those noises. I'm looking, what's happening?
I thought something
was wrong. He knew what he was doing, too. You know.
You're getting scared, Mike.
Yeah, and everybody else going, too. Eighth of an inch.
What's the dimension of the tenon, Clark?
What's that?
How big around the pin? What's the diameter?
You're shooting for
1/8.
1/8.
1/8 inch. 1/8 of an inch.
kind of supplanted.
Thank you.
We're trying to support our
individual win the bet.
How long are you going to make that 10?
About a quarter of an inch long.
It's
losing a lot of its support. Ah, it's almost there.
Now he's going to that
330. I got a little saw around here somewhere. Thank you. Thank you.
Just a question now. And you don't have to do that, but if you were to back off the pressure on your tailstock a little bit, would that stop that flexing?
It might. Let's see.
Oh, I mean, don't ruin the whole thing just to answer that question.
Nah, not much.
I don't know if I want to touch it.
Okay.
Need the smaller.
This is going to be the base.
A smaller tool rest, I would say.
No, this will be, I think it'll be all right. I do believe this is a piece of the Benga. Parting tool, measuring. Two and a quarter, and three quarters. Not take it off.
Oh, so he's going to ride the lane?
Mm-hmm. Being the slim pickings.
Thank you. slow it down a little bit. I know what I need to do. I'm going to need the tailstock again. One more time. There are people that do that. I figure after all that work I put in there trying to turn it, I don't want the wobble.
Steam it with
the ground. Really love that stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, but the bad thing about it, you don't know how much it's going to do. It might warp to the point where it won't stand up.
He's
going
to have to rechuck that.
You're right. Rechuck it.
Yeah.
Probably going to need it. I think I'm done with it. No, no, I wouldn't need it. I'm good for top.
You can make a goblet at the same piece, Frank.
I haven't got quite enough.
You got a little crack there on that end of that wood.
Where?
Right there, yeah.
This?
You got a couple little checks
there. Is that check? Sure. No, that's the wood. Come take a look. Come take a look.
It sure looks like it. It sure looks like coming all the way across.
Is that it? Is that
the
piece?
Yeah, that looks like a crack to me.
Where?
That's crack.
Oh, down there?
Right there. Right there.
Oh, okay. Have we got any super glue? Thin super glue? Anybody?
I think we might get some of the Kevin's.
Well, we can put it on later. Well, it may not hold. We'll see.
We'll move over here a little bit further.
Oh, really? Yeah.
We got to be out by 8:30.
Not now.
I'll sit up here just in case.
I might be able to get something out of this. Since pressed for time here. Gets this? Huh? Is it? Where's my other one? But no, I got the curve. I need the straight one. That's it. Whoever gets this is going to have a little sanding to do.
Somebody has to help me.
It's a little chatter work in there, too.
That's the foam, you know.
The rule of foam. What's that?
When you had that tendon on the other side, it was on the inside of the goblet.
Oh, the inside?
When you had it on that side.
Try finishing this without the tailstock. Because of time. A little less drag here.
an inch.
Oh, not an eighth.
Top of the gobbler or on the outside?
Huh? Right there. I had it a quarter of an inch. What's that? Just plugged in.
It was.
Set it on the table.
Yeah, it's
not the great part, right?
But I don't want any paint on it. Don't paint it. Jack thinks everything has to be painted.
Thank you, Frank.